So what we focus on in my mentor's lab, my mentor is Neil Bouchon, is diabetes, but the molecular reasons that people get diabetes. And so first we're going to start off with an introduction, just into a general introduction into diabetes, and then why studying the molecular mechanisms behind the development of diabetes. So, just so that everybody is properly oriented to where we're talking about, the human pancreas is located, if you can feel your rib cage, right under your rib cage is your liver, slightly under your liver and towards your left side is your stomach, and your stomach kind of curves around and starts your gut. And in that curve, right here, in the duodenal curve, is where your pancreas is. Okay? 93 to 98% of your pancreas is exocrine tissue. So after your stomach produces some of the digestive enzymes to start digesting your food, your pancreas actually produces even more digestive enzymes and excretes them directly into your intestinal tract. And those enzymes break down sugars and starches and things like that, as opposed to your stomach primarily breaks down protein. And so 95% of your pancreas is devoted to eating. In terms of secreting digestive enzymes to help you break down your food and uptake your food. The other 5 to 7% of your pancreas are these little structures called the islets of Langerhans. And within these structures, these are endocrine glands. There are about four to five different cell types. There are alpha cells, and alpha cells make a hormone called glucagon, which is important when you're not eating. The infamous beta cell, which produces insulin. Then there are delta cells that produce another hormone called somatostatin. Another type of cells called pancreatic polypeptide cells, and they make a protein called pancreatic polypeptide. And then a newly discovered cell type called ghrelin cells. So we're going to focus on these islets here. We'll see lots of actual real pictures of them. But particularly, we're interested in the beta cell. So your pancreas is really important, not just for, like I said, the secretion of these digestive enzymes to help you break down your food, but because there's a homeostatic there's a homeostatic mechanism that your pancreas is constantly trying to achieve by secreting insulin, which is to maintain your blood sugar at the proper concentrations. And so when you eat a meal, your blood sugar gets high. Your blood sugar gets high, this promotes insulin release from your pancreas. So your pancreas is going to then secrete insulin, and then insulin stimulates uptake of glucose from your blood by your tissue cells. So that's your muscle, your kidney, and your fat. But the primary target of glucose uptake is actually your brain and your liver. And so your liver gets the signal from insulin, starts to uptake glucose, and turns it into glycogen. Glycogen is just the storage form of glucose for your liver, and you store glucose in your liver for when you're not eating. Ever not eat for a long time and start to feel like your blood sugar is getting low? Well, when you feel like that, your liver then kicks in and starts breaking down glycogen and turns it back into glucose so that you don't pass out. So your liver will turn glucose into glycogen. And your tissues will take up glycogen, and this will lower your blood sugar. Then, when your blood sugar starts to get too low, what happens is low blood sugar promotes the release of glucagon from your pancreas. Then glucagon actually stimulates the breakdown of glycogen into glucose. Then your glucose is released from your liver and goes back into your bloodstream to raise your blood sugar when your blood sugar is getting too low. This is a homeostatic loop to maintain proper blood sugar concentration levels at all times. So then when that loop isn't working properly, that's when we get diabetes. Diabetes is an international epidemic, such that globally 246 million people around the world have diabetes in 2007. And just 4 years ago, in 2003, the figure was at about 194 million. There are three countries in the world with the largest diabetic populations: India and China, both with over a million citizens, have almost about 40 million citizens with diabetes, and the U.S., on the other hand, has about 21 million citizens with diabetes. But diabetes is also a cultural epidemic within the African-American community, such that of the 20.7 million people with diabetes in the U.S., 2.7 to 3.3 million of them are African American, which is a large percentage. And one-third of the African American diabetics, and this is actually a statistic that goes for all people who have diabetics, about one-third of all people who have diabetes do not know that they have diabetes. African Americans are 1.6 times more likely to have diabetes than non-Latino whites. 25% of African Americans in their latter years have diabetes. And one out of four of every African American woman over the age of 55 will have diabetes. Once we have diabetes, we are actually much more likely to suffer severe consequences from diabetes, such that because there's already an elevated risk for stroke and cardiovascular disease within the African American community, your risk of suffering from stroke or cardiovascular disease is compounded by having diabetes. You're also 2 times more likely to suffer from diabetic retinopathy or retinopathy, which is a condition of the microvasculature in the back of your eye that leads to blindness. You're 2.5 more times to need lower limb amputations, and 5.6 more times more likely to suffer from diabetes-related kidney failure. But there is good news. So even with all of those bad statistics, type 2 diabetes in particular can be delayed or prevented in overweight adults that have a condition called prediabetes. And what prediabetes is that we can already measure your blood glucose levels and tell that it's elevated above what it's supposed to be, but you haven't gotten to the point of being where the diabetic levels are. And so if people with prediabetes lose 5 to 7% of their body weight, which would be about 10 to 15 pounds if you're over 200 pounds. If you're physically active for at least 30 minutes a day, 5 days a week, and that activity can be brisk walking, but with some sort of physical activity, and you make healthier food choices and limit the amounts of calories and fat in your diet. That doesn't mean that you have to, go on an Atkins diet. That doesn't limit fat in your diet, actually. This means you have to eat better. You have to eat properly. Those three things compounded can truly keep you from getting diabetes. And if you already have it, it will go a long way to improving your So there are two types of diabetes. And so if you imagine that insulin is what lets sugar into your cells. So you eat, okay, and sugar wants to get into your cells. In type 1 diabetes, you have an autoimmune destruction of your insulin cell, which then results in insufficient insulin production. So you're not making enough insulin to actually get the sugar into your cells when you have type 1 diabetes. On the other hand, when you have type 2 diabetes, there's an actual buildup in your body of insulin resistance, such that your body can, and that's either your peripheral tissues and or your liver, has an increased metabolic demand for insulin, and your body cannot provide enough insulin to meet that demand. And so you can think about that as insulin is trying its best to get sugar in, but because you're insulin resistant, it won't actually get into the cell. And so for people who already have diabetes, there are several lines of treatment options. So diet, exercise, and blood sugar control are the first target to help people who already have diabetes. What we need to do is get their blood sugar under control, encourage them to exercise, and change their eating habits, like you said. That will go a long way in preventing diabetes, but also helping people who already have it. If diet and exercise are not enough to control your blood sugar, also management of diabetes with either insulin and or other drugs and medications is another treatment option. For people who have type 1 diabetes or have kidney failure, and type 2 diabetes, what is also possible is a pancreas transplant. So if you have kidney failure, and you're getting a kidney transplant, you have a matching donor, pancreas transplants are actually not very high, as high in demand as a kidney transplant. So if they're taking a donor's kidney, you sometimes can also get them to take the donor pancreas and get a pancreas transplant if you're a severe diabetic. Finally, and that goes for type 1 and type 2 diabetics. Finally, the newest, I would say, transplant therapy would be islet transplant, where there's someone who's been willing to donate their organs. We isolate those 5% of islet cells from the entire pancreas, and you can actually transplant those, just the islet cells, not the whole pancreas, into a patient. The only problem with islet transplant therapy is that it's been going on for about 7 years now. And what we find is that the islets stop working at about 5 years. So they did all this improvement and it's working out really well, but what's happening is that the islets kind of give out after about 5 years and they're in need of another transplant. So either way you cut your cookies, whether you have type 1 diabetes and your beta cells are not producing enough insulin, or you have type 2 diabetes and you're insulin resistant so your beta cells cannot produce enough insulin, you're not making insulin to meet your metabolic needs when you have diabetes. So our lab studies is how to make more functional beta cells that are responsive to a person's metabolic needs. And so the way that we do that is to study how cell cycle molecules are the proteins within your cell that are involved in making your cells divide and replicate. What we study is how cell cycle molecules are involved in the establishment of beta cell mass from stem cells, how beta cells expand throughout embryonic and postnatal development. So that's from during embryogenesis to birth, and then from birth throughout adulthood. And then we also study how beta cell mass is maintained. Because even as an adult, you go through weight fluctuations, stress fluctuations, pregnancy, if you're a female, and your beta cell mass is actually very plastic and will expand and decrease as necessary to meet your metabolic demand at that time. So by being able to understand all of these different ways the beta cells are established, expanded, and maintained, we can get a better sense of how to guide your natural beta cells into regenerating more beta cells. So for people who already have diabetes, like we said, there are several treatment options, but an additional treatment option that's forecasted is stem cell transplantation. And so how would that work? If you have a patient with the disease, i.e. diabetes, the idea behind this is to take some disease-free cells from the patient, any cell from your body, and then transfer a nucleus from the cell, the DNA from this cell, into an egg that has no nucleus. Okay? It's actually absolutely amazing that an egg does not need sperm to divide. You give it a nucleus that has 46 chromosomes in it, and shock it with a little bit of electricity, it's going to divide in and of itself. And so once you transplant this egg, shock it with a little bit of electricity, it will actually begin to divide and form an embryo. Okay? After you form an embryo, you can actually recover the stem cells from the embryo, grow them in culture, get them to differentiate into beta cells, and then transplant these beta cells back into this person. That's the idea. What's really funny is we were talking about the Nobel Prize earlier, before the talk started. I was watching television, I think I was eating breakfast Monday morning watching CNN, and the headline is, Nobel laureates have been given prize for using stem cells to cure diabetes and cancer. And I thought to myself, well, what the hell do I get up and work every day for? I miss the news flash. And the Nobel Prize was actually given to two gentlemen, actually three scientists who came up with this sort of technology, with being able to transplant a nucleus into a cell, make it divide, figure out how to take the stem cells from it, but also to figure out how to take these eggs, transplant them into mice, and then come up with clones of mice, and then being able to mutate that DNA, to take some genes out, put genes in, things like that. That's what the Nobel Prize was given for. And so, in medicine and physiology this year. And so the news will mistake two things, because when he said it, I was like, well, then I just need to look for another job because somebody's already figured this out and I just missed the news flash. But this is part of the technology that the Nobel Prize was awarded for this year. And so this is the idea behind how stem cell technology will work. Where we are as a scientific community in terms of beta cells is that there actually has been a lab that claims that they can get a cell to differentiate and produce insulin. But the cell won't actually release the insulin out. It'll kind of make it, but it doesn't properly function as a beta cell. And so that's kind of where we are as a community with how to make stem cells differentiate into beta cells, but it's one lab claims they do it, and no one else has been able to replicate this yet. So it's still a long, long ways away from actually working. So the relationship that your body has to actual beta cell mass, right? So the amount of insulin producing cells that you have in relationship to your body and how that can cause or prevent diabetes is becoming clearer. So work from our center has shown that if you are a non-diabetic obese person, you have a significant amount of beta cells. What's funny is people think, oh, when you're obese, you get diabetes. That's not true. Only 20% of obese people actually get diabetes. About 100% of them are insulin resistant. But their bodies can make enough insulin to overcome that insulin resistance and not become diabetic. So for our non-diabetic obese patients, they have a beta cell volume of about 3% of their pancreas. But for those who have that pre-diabetic condition, they have significantly less, just about half of the beta cell mass that a non-diabetic has. And for the people who are full-blown type 2 diabetics, they have even less beta cell mass than their pre-diabetic counterparts. And the same trend holds true for lean people, for people who are not obese, such that they don't have quite as much beta cell mass as obese people because they're not quite as large, so they don't need to produce insulin resistant, so they don't need to produce as much insulin. But in comparison to lean type 2 diabetics, they also have a significantly decreased beta cell mass than their non-diabetic counterparts. So this points to the fact that the actual numbers of beta cells that your body has is significant in your development of diabetes. At the same time, we've also come with some data, or we've also produced some data that shows that as your beta cell mass decreases, and that's this graph going this way, your blood glucose increases. And it's a curvy linear relationship that has a breaking point. So you can actually get pretty low in terms of how much beta cell mass you have and not be diabetic. But once you pass this critical point of below about 2% of your actual pancreas volume being beta cells, your blood sugar starts to shoot up exponentially. So there's a clear relationship that says we need to have a particular beta cell mass to be able to prevent diabetes. So what we do is study how to establish and expand beta cell mass. So, beta cell mass is established, is expanded, and maintained differently throughout development. So, during embryogenesis, when your pancreas is being formed from stem cells, what happens is that you have these progenitor cells that express a particular protein called PDX1. And they must express PDX1 before they can directly differentiate into a beta cell. So there are lots of people out there studying all of the different steps that happen from PDX1 expression to insulin expression. And then that's what they're trying to recapitulate in stem cells in vitro for transplantation in people. After birth, from like birth to what we would call through adolescence. So mice go from like 0 to 18 years in 21 days. So we call that postnatal development, such that after 21 days, they're fully self-sustaining and able to fend for themselves. And so during postnatal development, a mouse goes from being an itsy-bitsy newborn to being a full-blown young adult. And so in those 21 days, your beta cell mass has to expand exponentially to compensate for the exponential amount of growth that's going on in the animal in general. And so that expansion of beta cell mass isn't direct differentiation from stem cells, but instead is regulated by the replication or duplication of beta cells themselves to expand the beta cell mass. So once you're an adult and you kind of have a pretty stable, you know, body size and body mass index, what happens is that replication.
Together, we don't get the apoptosis that we were seeing. Instead, we get a lot of proliferation. We can generate more and more PDX1-positive cells. So what that tells us is that in the absence of this inhibitor, you don't get proper differentiation. These cells will continue to divide. And they don't undergo apoptosis. So before, when they weren't, then they didn't have the inhibitor, but they still got the signal, the back and forth signal that said to differentiate. When they got that conflicting message, they would go on to apoptose. When we take that message away, they actually don't go on to apoptose. They just continue to cycle and proliferate. So this allowed us to build a model. It basically says that the signal receiving cell needs to downregulate the inhibitor so they can continue to renew. And that the signal sending cell, the one that actually wants to become a beta cell, has to upregulate the inhibitor to actually differentiate. So that's how our work relates to stem cell research. So we know that this level of proliferative control is mediated by P57. But once these cells actually go on to differentiate and be beta cells and be functional, they don't cycle very often. They're prevented from cycling. So now our next question was, what is this level of proliferative control? So again, for those who have diabetes, we have all of these treatments. And then we already discussed what stem cell transplantation would do. But the focus of our lab is also beta cell regeneration. Okay? So how can we get your beta cells that are still healthy to regenerate more of themselves? As a therapeutic for people who have diabetes, because if you have more beta cells produce more insulin, then you don't have such a, you can meet your metabolic demands for insulin and maintain your normal glucose levels. And so what we found was that there was another cyclin-dependent kinase inhibitor that kept these differentiated cells out of the cell cycle, and that one is called P27. It's a relative of P57. And in the absence of P27, so this is in the presence of P27, our differentiated cell types here, they're not cycling. But in the presence, in the absence of P27, we see that they're cycling improperly, a lot. And these are insulin cells that should not be cycling, as we see here, but they are cycling a lot. So when our insulin cells cycle improperly, once they've differentiated, we don't get the same phenotype as we do with the P57, where they go on and die from apoptosis. Instead, we get a whole lot of beta cells, which is exactly what we need. What was actually funny about this was that even though they have so many beta cells, they still are glucose intolerant. They still have an elevated blood glucose level. So we produce all these beta cells, but are they functional? Because if they still are glucose intolerant, the beta cells must not be working. And that's not what we found. If you look at normal animals, and this is, if you fast them overnight, this would be what their insulin concentration is. Then you give them a bolus of glucose, and so it's kind of like them having a meal. When you do that, your insulin should go up because you now have sugar in your system. And so we see that increase that we're supposed to see in the wild type, but in the mutant, they start with more insulin, and they secrete more insulin in response. So those additional beta cells that we have, they are working. But what we then did is an insulin tolerance test to see if these animals were insulin resistant, right? Because insulin resistance is a hallmark of people who have type 2 diabetes. What we find is that they are insulin resistant. The mutants have higher resistance to insulin than their wild type counterparts, which explains why, even though they're making more insulin, they are a diabetic. So we said to ourselves, okay, great. We figured out what we needed to make them make more insulin cells. But because we're using this animal model, it kind of confounds what's going on because they're already insulin resistant. So what we wanted to do was say, okay, what if we induce diabetes, like a type 1 sort of diabetes where we just kill all of just the beta cells, just the cells that are producing insulin. We have a drug called streptozotocin. We give the animal streptozotocin, it induces diabetes. So if we kill all of the insulin cells, in the absence of P27, will those cells be able to cycle and replenish the beta cell population? So this is technically a therapeutic for people who have type 1 diabetes. And what we find is the streptozotocin that affects the animal similarly. Okay, so this is the animal before streptozotocin treatment, and these are the animals after streptozotocin treatment. So they lose a lot of their insulin-producing cells. But what we notice over here is that the mutant doesn't raise its blood glucose level like the wild type. So our question was why? And what we find is that the mutant beta cells are able to proliferate, to repopulate the pancreas, and the wild type cells are not. And so because they can't repopulate the pancreas, they go on to have severe diabetes, while these animals do not become diabetic. So our conclusion from this study was that the knockout beta cells show an increased propensity to regenerate after streptozotocin-induced diabetes, which then makes P27 a viable candidate for diabetic therapeutics that induce beta cell replication. So we're going to skip a lot of this because it's already 1 o'clock. And our next question was, like I said, in the beginning when I showed you the graph about the diabetic obese people and the non-diabetic obese people, that most obese people are insulin resistant, but only 20% of them become diabetic. That's because in response to their obesity, they create more insulin-producing cells to compensate for their insulin resistance. So that phenomenon is called adaptive expansion or compensatory adaptation, either way you want to say it. And so our question was, if we use an animal that is insulin resistant and has already shown that because of its insulin resistance, it can compensatorily adapt its beta cell mass to meet its insulin demands, not becoming diabetic, what if we take away the molecule that we know prevents these cells from cycling? If we take away the molecule we know allows these cells to cycle, will they still be able to expand properly? Okay? So the idea here, if we take this back to humans, is that those 20% of the obese people who can't expand their beta cell mass, they can't expand it because they're missing something. And so maybe this is what they're missing. Maybe this molecule that we knock out, and it's called cyclin D2, is the molecule that's required for the adaptive expansion of your beta cell mass. And so what we had to do was to create a double knockout mouse that was missing a gene that would make it insulin resistant, but also missing the gene that controls beta cell replication. And so what we did is the way that we made these mice insulin resistant is that we knocked out the insulin receptor pathway. So when your pancreas secretes insulin, in your liver and your peripheral tissues, insulin has to bind a receptor, and then it goes on to activate this huge cogwork of machinery. So we decided to knock out a key piece of that machinery such that there would be no response to insulin in these animals. And they're called IRS1 knockout animals. And so when we create the double knockout, what we find is that they're much smaller, but they have a highly elevated blood glucose level in comparison to all of their counterparts. So the regular IRS1 animals that are able to expand their beta cell mass and adapt to their insulin resistance, they're not diabetic. Their blood glucose is less than half of what the double knockout animals are. These double knockout animals are insulin resistant and are missing a gene that controls beta cell expansion. And so if we actually look at their islets and see what they look like, we can see that the double knockout islets look very different than the huge islets that are from the animal that is able to adapt and expand. We can actually quantify it, and we can see this is the animal that has the ability to adapt and expand, and here is the double knockout. So it has a significantly decreased beta cell mass because it's missing the promoter of beta cell division, cyclin D2. And because it has such a low beta cell mass, it's extremely glucose intolerant. And when it eats, its blood sugar just goes up. And that we can show that they are just as insulin resistant as the animals that can expand their beta cell mass. So it's not that we lost the insulin resistance phenotype. We maintained it.
Senta, which one of the purple ones are the DKO?
This one.
Oh, that one, okay.
And so they have these really small islets, and we can see that when they eat and after they eat, they really can't produce insulin. As opposed to the animal that's insulin resistant, after it eats, it produces a whole lot of insulin in response to its increased blood sugar from eating. And even a wild type of animal, again, where it produces insulin in response to eating. But our double knockout animal has these itsy bitsy islets and can't make any insulin. And so our conclusion from these studies were that cyclin D2 is essential for the expansion of beta cell mass, even under the pressure of insulin resistance. Because there are theories out there that say, well, once insulin resistance sets in, maybe stem cells can be activated from some place in your body that are hiding, and maybe they can be activated to repopulate your pancreas. Well, what we show is that that's not true. You need in adulthood in the pancreas to be able to replicate to replenish your beta cells. And so all of this work taken together shows that understanding how the signals to direct beta cell replication is the next step in developing therapeutics that induce beta cell regeneration for diabetic patients. So as we gain more insight into the mechanisms that govern beta cell replication, the use of therapeutics to stimulate endogenous beta cell proliferation would be a tangible reality. And our final message is that cookies are sometimes food. That's what Cookie Monster now says. It's no longer like cookie, cookie, cookie. He likes carrots and things like that now. And I'd like to thank my PI, Emil, my mentor, because he's been a great mentor over the past 6 years. I've learned a lot and had the opportunity to publish a lot. All the members of our lab, past and present, and in particular technicians and undergraduate students that I've worked with. We received the P57 knockout mice from Kumin Zhang at Baylor University, Rohit Kulkarni at the Joslin Diabetes Institute at Harvard, sent us the IRS1 knockout mice, Peter Szczynski at Harvard sent the second D2 knockout mice, Neil Siegel sent the P57 knockout mice, P27 knockout mice, and Roshiro Kayagama sent the P27 knockout mice to Neil. And my funding while I was a graduate student was on the UCLA Cellular and Molecular Biology Training Grant, and our lab has funding from the NIH, the NIDK, and the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation. Thank you.
So, Senta, you've been doing a lot of exciting research, and thank you for the presentation. But when will that translate over to everyday patients who have diabetes to see the beta cell?
How about this?
Okay, how about it?
When the Human Genome Project was started, and they figured out, in the beginning, the Human Genome Project was slated to last like 15, 17, 20 years. And they figured out it could be done in about 8. The JDRF made an announcement and said, we will have the genome done. Not the JDRF did it, but the genome will be done, and we will be able to eradicate type 1 diabetes by 2000. How many disappointed patients do they have today? And so it's one of those questions that I don't really like to answer, because every time you unlock a problem, I don't want to call it a Pandora's box, but it's like those Russian dolls that stack together. Like, you open one, and you're like, yes, I've got the answer. And then there's another doll that you have to figure out how to open up to get to the answer until we get to the bottom of it. Stem cell technology is not in our immediate future. We would actually be much better off with finding a therapeutic that we can specifically target to beta cells to induce beta cell replication. And that will come faster than stem cell technology, in my opinion. But I would never put a time date on it.
The adaptive increase in beta cell mass, is it dependent on angiogenesis? And if so, is that part of a needed signaling mechanism, or is it independent of that?
So, actually, islet cells are highly vascularized. But the knockout animals of like VEGF, which would be the vascular endothelial growth factor, don't show severe islet phenotypes. Like when you knock it out specifically. The growth factors that induce beta cell replication are, I don't want to say a mystery. We know that IGF can induce beta cell replication. Insulin itself is a growth factor for beta cells. I actually think the beta cells have very, very specific and tightly controlled mechanisms that prevent them from cycling, more so than other cell types, because it's extremely specific as far as my research has found, and you can't substitute one family member in for another. So the expansion of beta cell mass is not necessarily dependent on angiogenesis directly, but indirectly, because beta cells are so highly vascularized, increased angiogenesis is necessary to be able to develop, to be able to deliver insulin properly to the organism. But like the VEGF knockout doesn't necessarily, this pancreas specific VEGF knockout doesn't necessarily have a phenotype that shows that it can't reproduce its beta cells, as far as been reported.
Can you briefly discuss your future replant?
Right now I'm actually moving away from direct cell cycle things, and I'm looking at epigenetics. And what epigenetics is how genes are silenced by changes in DNA structure, chromatin structure. And so we're looking at how epigenetic changes, what I'm specifically looking at is how epigenetic changes between that progenitor and that differentiation, the differentiated cell, that PDX1 positive cell versus an insulin positive cell. What are the epigenetic changes that happen? And what are the molecules that mediate those epigenetic changes, changes in the DNA structure, to silence some genes and unsilence others? I'm doing that till April. And then I'm looking forward to moving on to another postdoc in bioethics.
Well, once again, we'd like to thank Dr. Georgia for coming up.
Thank you for having me. This is not your normal North Campus lunch lecture, so I appreciate your attention.
In the rare cases of an insulinoma, I don't know if you can produce that adequate model. Do you know whether that non-adaptive increase in beta cell mass is a matter of loss of apoptosis?
Okay.
Or are there some other signaling mechanisms that cause?
So insulinomas are rare, and there are lots of models, especially cell cycles, of overexpression and knockout models that produce extreme increases in beta cell mass that they don't necessarily turn insulinomas, because they actually still look very normal. One of the few insulinoma models is a P27, P18 double knockout. Or a menin knockout. Again, menin is an epigenetic regulator, so in the absence of menin, you get improper silencing of P27 and P18, so cycle inhibitors. Excuse me for one second. You
guys look at shell shock. Don't worry, we won't get the quiz until next Friday.
Don't worry. I won't be here.
We'll find you. It's a take home.
No, my brother is dying.
Oh, okay.
I gave my last one to Jasmine. Oh, wait. Oh. Yes, I gave
Okay, I can send you her email address, and you can just add it to the list, sir.
Yeah,
okay.
Could you send that to like everybody in the list?
Right.
I mean, send that to me.
Her email?
Yeah, I would like those emails.
Oh, you know, I can't just be giving out to any old guy. I gotta get her from